and welcome to Background Briefing, available 24/7 at backgroundbriefing.org. I'm Ian Masters, and today we'll examine a number of stories and issues in the news. We'll begin with the Biden administration authorizing Ukraine to use U.S., followed by French and British longer-range missiles, to strike into Russia in response to the deployment of North Korean troops by Putin, who has yet to respond, although his Kremlin spokesman has issued dire warnings about this escalation. Joining us is Lawrence Wilkerson, a retired United States Army colonel and former chief of staff to United States Secretary of State Colin Powell. In 2005, he went public with his knowledge that Vice President Cheney had provided the guidance that led to America's torture disgrace in Guantanamo, Abu Ghraib, and elsewhere, and he is now a senior fellow at the Eisenhower Media Network. Then we'll assess how the Democrats can move forward to meaningfully address a deepening crisis of liberal democracy without confronting the economic conditions that gave rise to right-wing populism, and speak with Wendy Brown, a professor of social thought at the Institute of Social Science at the Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton. She was formerly a professor of political science at the University of California, Berkeley, where she was a core faculty member in the designated emphasis in critical theory. Her books include Undoing the Demos, Neoliberalism, Stealth Revolution, Walled States, Waning Sovereignty, and In the Ruins of Neoliberalism, The Rise of Anti-Democratic Politics in the West. Her latest book is Nihilistic Times, Thinking Max Weber, and we'll discuss her article at Dissent, A Party Out of Touch. Before we begin, rather than escape to Canada for some imaginary sanctuary from MAGA fascism, we now must stand our ground and rebuild an opposition movement that will bridge the divide Trump has exploited with false promises to his voters in order to reward his billionaire buddies who have already bought the Supreme Court and are in the process of buying the entire government. Being educated doesn't make you an elitist, and knowledge and opportunity should be shared with those left behind who are our brothers and sisters, not our enemies. So Background Briefing's mission of building a reality-based community in post-truth America is now more urgent than ever, and as one of Trump's enemies of the people, join me in a struggle between the plutocrats who no longer believe in democracy and the people who have to defend it or see it die. Please make a tax-deductible donation at backgroundbriefing.org/donate or at our foundation, publictruthmedia.org. And thank you as we work to make a more perfect union in the land of the free and the home of the brave. And joining us now is Lawrence Wilkerson, a retired United States Army colonel and former chief of staff to United States Secretary of State Colin Powell. In 2005, he went public with his knowledge that Vice President Cheney had provided the guidance that led to America's torture disgrace at Guantanamo, Abu Ghraib, and elsewhere, and he is now a senior fellow at the Eisenhower Media Network. Welcome to Background Briefing, Lawrence Wilkerson.
Good to be with you, Ian.
Well, thanks for joining us, Larry. And what do you make of the latest moves on the part of the outgoing President Biden, who's authorized Ukraine to use U.S. ATACMS, longer-range missiles? And, of course, the French will follow with their Scalp missiles and the U.K. with their Storm Shadows missiles. We haven't heard from Putin, but his Kremlin spokesman has issued rather dire warnings about this escalation. What do you think of it?
I think, first of all, we have heard from Putin, as well as probably the most accomplished diplomat in the world today, Sergei Lavrov. And by that, I mean he has made it quite clear earlier and yesterday, re-emphasized it, that such moves are out of the pale as far as he's concerned, because they signify that, and with the TACMs, it's clear that they signify NATO, in this case, Washington, joining the fight. And he withholds to himself, and under international law, he's right, in the law of land warfare, he's right, to respond accordingly as he sees fit. But let's back up for a moment and look at this a little more closely. First of all, a TACMS is not a very formidable missile. It only has a range of roughly 190 miles. Our attempts to extend that range, I'm told, have been successful out to 600, maybe 700 miles, But I don't believe we're going to be giving those missiles because I'm not even sure they've been tested well yet. So 190 miles is, this is a country of 11 time zones. That's a drop in the bucket with regard to this country, 190 miles. And I also understand that we've given them with the express, or we've given permission with the express instruction that they can only be used against the salient, the Ukrainians established in Kursk, which is within range, but which is about to be annihilated, is in the process of being annihilated right now by Russian troops. So it's really a tempest in a teapot when you talk about the equipment, but it's not in terms of what it signifies to Putin, as Putin has very carefully and prudently said. It signifies NATO joining the fight in a way that gives him the right to respond to Warsaw, to Germany, to France, or any other country where he finds a target that he can say is indeed supporting the war in Ukraine and strike it. That's dangerous, very dangerous.
Well, the Biden administration, of course, justifies this because of North Korean troops operating in the Kursk salient.
Well, this is a very curious thing because I have checked with everyone that still will talk with me in the intelligence community, in the Pentagon, overseas, in Russia, in Ukraine, in Albania, and a number of other places, and no one knows where the North Koreans are, nor does anyone know if they have, in fact, quote, joined the fight, unquote. And most tell me, especially the intelligence experts, that it's all a rumor cooked up by the United States, played in by Britain and other countries too. But it's all a rumor that the North Koreans, if they are there even in any kind of strength, or there in maybe a light division strength, and that they're around the Kursk area, again, because that is Russian territory. And that sounds like Putin to me. If he were going to put them someplace, he'd probably put them in Russian territory to attack or assist in attacking people who were invading Russian territory. Again, he's on firm ground here because he has a defense treaty with North Korea, and they would be, in fact, fulfilling that treaty. I don't think that's going to happen because I don't think North Korea wants the headaches of being caught in this fight. And I think this is, on Putin's part, it's simply a demonstration of tit for tat. You've got all kinds of countries participating with you. Now I've got some participating for me. And by the way, I think my SCTO, my Security Collective Treaty Organization, is a more formidable alliance than NATO. And certainly closer together and tighter together because NATO is falling apart. I think that's the message Putin is trying to send with this so-called North Korean rumor.
And you mentioned Germany. The German Chancellor Scholz, who's at the G20 in Rio de Janeiro, he's been getting criticism for his recent phone call with Putin. But the Germans aren't going to deploy their Taurus missiles, I take it.
No, and he's in trouble. The German chancellor's in political trouble. I don't think he'll last much longer. The worrisome thing is that the rise of political parties in Germany signals that a very Marie Le Pen, even right of Marie Le Pen, the alternative for Deutschland party, might be gaining power at a fast rate enough to perhaps assemble a coalition itself once he's ousted, and his tenure will not be much longer. I think we're going to see similar kind of political upheavals in other countries too, as it becomes quite clear to Europe and to NATO in particular, Brussels, that not only has Ukraine lost and Russia won, every day that goes by strengthens Putin's negotiating position and weakens Zelensky's and thus the West's negotiating position. So we have a lot of time to go to January the 20th, and that situation is only going to get worse in that period of time. So Trump coming in will have, I think, a good situation in terms of closing down the war, ceasefire and a peace agreement, negotiations leading thereto. but a bad situation in terms of those negotiations. And this is what worries me deeply, because Trump is a transactional guy, if nothing else. And he's the art of the deal guy. And if he gets in there with people like Sergey Lavrov and Vladimir Putin himself, and they're negotiating and Putin has the stronger hand, it's going to be very difficult for Trump to forge a deal that looks like he's been successful in any real way, particularly in concert with what the Biden administration was doing beforehand. So it's going to be a dicey situation. And if Trump comes away from that, having been rebuffed more or less by the negotiating process, like he did North Korea when he more or less, you know, made his overture to North Korea's leader and then rebuffed him and was rebuffed by him in turn, and now North Korea is an ally of Moscow, it's not going to be a good picture for Trump.
And do you think that Putin could retaliate by, for example, giving missiles to the Houthis? I mean, that's the logic of his response.
Yeah, he's already doing that. I'm convinced of that. The Houthis are getting help from China. They're getting help from Russia. They're getting help from Iran. It may be coming through Tehran, but it's coming not just from Tehran. It's coming from Russia and China, too. And they have a significant interest in it. And you'll note, I've been tracking the ships struck in the Red Sea. In the beginning, they may have made an error or two in their targeting, but they haven't hit China's ships, and they haven't hit other ships. And basically, their criterion seems to be, if you're supporting or seem to be supporting the brutal genocide in Gaza, we're going to hit you. If you're not, and even better, if you're speaking out against it, we're not going to hit you. So the Houthis are playing a pretty smart game, actually.
What about, though, the fact that Egypt is losing all that revenue? And I imagine China, being a major trading nation, can't be happy about the Suez being closed down.
That is a problem. But China has gotten, in the last decade or so, Base Road Initiative spinoffs, if you will, that, for example, and I think this is one of the reasons Biden is waging this conflict through Ukraine as a proxy against Russia. China has shortened its delivery, if you will, to 16 hours from its major Pacific ports into the heart of Europe. And how did they do that? They built a rail. And that rail takes, as I said, about 16 hours for moving produce from China from its even furthest Pacific port into the heart of Europe. It was going to debouch in Ukraine. Ukraine was going to be more or less sort of the interpole for China's entry into Europe in this big fashion. That cuts down, by the way, that rail cuts down China's transit from anywhere to 2.5 to 3 days going through the strait or around the horn or whatever, considerably. So it's a real boost for China's trade. And they're angry about that. And I think that was part of the reason that's never been announced by Sullivan or Blinken or Biden, that we started this conflict in Ukraine. Putin invaded, of course, and that was aggression and under international law wrong, but we gave him every provocation to invade. And I think that's one of the reasons that we did, along with making money for the military-industrial complex and also trying to reestablish our economic hegemony over Europe. That's why we took down Nord Stream 2, and we did. There's no question about it in my mind. We blew up the pipeline. We did that because we wanted to teach Germany that it had to turn away from China and away from Russia and be under our thumb. What we did, of course, was destroy one of the best manufacturing centers in the world, in Germany. They're a basket case right now in terms of manufacturing because the price of energy has been so steep and it's been so difficult to compromise on it that much of that industry is shut down or left Germany. So we have really hurt Germany. And when this winter comes and they have to pay the prices they're paying for the energy they're getting, which is much dirtier energy than the clean energy they were getting from Russia, as clean as methane can be, they're going to be very angry. And I suspect this alternative for Deutschland party may get even more adherence and may wind up putting together the governing coalition in Germany. And that's going to be very, very bad for us. And I think bad for Europe as a whole. on your question of China losing money and so forth, it's nothing like Israel. Israel's port of Eilat is bankrupt. There's nothing going into Eilat or coming out of Eilat. It's bankrupt. And this is happening all across Israel now. You have probably the worst economic situation in Israel since 1948, and it just has no prospect of improving. Israel is going to have to be on our dole, if you will, for a number of years in the future if it's to survive, because its economy will require at least a decade to come back. It's partly because they put 300,000 plus of people, reservists, who work in that economy into the military and into the fight. And it's a year now plus, counting Lebanon and Gaza, and those people aren't in their jobs. I'm told that probably 30% of the reservists yesterday, day before yesterday, were about to rebel and say that they're going back to their jobs because their families can't eat, their families have no wherewithal, the economic situation is dire for them. And Netanyahu has made it this way. I frankly think Netanyahu's tenure is going to come to a halt, and it's going to be forced on him by the Israelis if someone doesn't shoot him.
So let's just take a brief station break, and we'll be back in a moment continuing the conversation with Lawrence Wilkerson, a retired United States Army colonel and former chief of staff to United States Secretary of State Colin Powell. Welcome back. I'm Ian Masters, and this is Background Briefing, available 24/7 at backgroundbriefing.org. And we're continuing the conversation with Lawrence Wilkerson, a retired United States Army colonel and a former chief of staff to United States Secretary of State Colin Powell. So we're just talking about Israel. What's your sense then of the people that Trump has appointed to the highest offices? There's obviously a lot of controversy about the DOJ appointment. Matt Gaetz, the Secretary of Defense appointment, who turns out to have problems with assaulting a woman and paying her off. The DNI appointment, of course, has got the intelligence community up in arms. And Bobby Kennedy Jr. at HHS seems to be, at this point, the most likely to be confirmed from what we're hearing from the Senate. But what do you make of the rest of them, though? I mean, the neocons, if you will. I find that kind of surprising that Secretary of State is an unreconstructed neocon. Senator Marco Rubio, you've got Elise Stefanik, a huge defender of Israel, APAC type at the United Nations. And you've got China Hawk, representing Mike Waltz as well, as a national security advisor. What do you make of that?
And Peter Hegseth, he's very much a neoconservative, a flaming neoconservative in my view. I think we're seeing typical Trump. I don't think any of these principal cabinet officers and reasonable facsimiles thereof, like the DNI, will be around 9, 10, 11 months down the road. I think he will have fired them all. If they could get confirmed, as in the case of Matt Gaetz, I think it's very, very questionable whether he can get confirmed. I think Senator Thune being made the leader of the Senate was a case in point that the Congress may be all Republican, but it's not all Trump necessarily. And so they're going to give some of these people, I think, a pretty good vetting. And this idea that he's going to get them to approve recess appointments across the board doesn't really cure anything, because then they will go after a year or go through a confirmation process. So I don't think we're going to see any of these people, Hegseth, if he's confirmed, Rubio is running for president. And Rubio never met a South American country from Venezuela to Argentina to Nicaragua that he doesn't want to overthrow the ruler in. So this guy is not going to last either. I think we're going to see a whole new slate after a year, and this is all Trump's tactic. He stirs things up. He makes things ripe and rich with controversy, news headlines, photographs of him firing people and so forth. But there's not going to be much continuity to policy, and I'm not so sure he doesn't want that, because he, as he said so many times, is going to be the person doing the policy. Now, whether we like that policy or whether it's sane policy or even smart policy is another matter altogether. But I think he's going to be the one doing the policy. These people are just going to be ancillary to the task and gotten rid of pretty soon because of the very reasons that you've just stated and I've tried to illuminate. They're all controversial, and they're all going to be operating at least in part at cross purposes to their boss.
But Trump seems averse to using military action, but at the same time, he's got these neocons who, and he is, of course, close to Netanyahu, who still wants to get the United States to go to war against Iran. So what are the chances of that?
Well, that's the most worrisome aspect of it, because the one place where Trump, I think, really is not adverse to war is on behalf of Israel. Otherwise, I think he's honest, if one can say that about him, in his disdain for war. I think some of his most powerful comments, for example, earlier, were about the war in Iraq that we started in 2003. I think he felt that way about it, and I think that was a genuine comment, and I think he was right. But Israel's a different matter. We've seen what he did with things like not calling the occupied territories the occupied territories, but Israel, moving the embassy to Jerusalem. And there's just more probably in his suitcase for Bibi Netanyahu. Although, if you look back at some of the previous comments that Trump has made about Trump, about Netanyahu, are pretty smart and pretty correct. He actually said that a few years ago, he said in an interview that Bibi Netanyahu was the impediment to two-state solution and to peace in general, which is absolutely the case. He's always been the impediment ever since he's been finance minister. More than 20 years, he's been the impediment. In many respects, Bibi Netanyahu and his uproarious political campaign, stirring up the settlers, was responsible for the assassination of Yitzhak Rabin, and thus the ending of any kind of peace party in Israel. So Netanyahu bears a burden, and that burden is not just his personal one, where he's been caught taking bribes for German submarines and other things, and probably ought to be in jail, but he's now really in trouble with a number of segments of the Israeli people, not least of whom are those who have hostages and want the hostages back. And in other cases where he fired Yoav Gallant, who is primarily liked by the Israeli people, and put a sycophant, Israel Katz, in there in his place, a man who hasn't served in the IDF for 20 some odd years and only served at the very lowest levels. So he's in trouble. He's in big trouble. But I could see Trump bailing him out of that trouble. He didn't get the 100 million from Miriam Adelson, but I'm told he did get 30 million. So he probably feels a little shortchanged by Miriam, but nonetheless, he's probably going to do what she wants him to do. And I think what he appears to want to do now himself, and that is support Israel to the hilt. Does that include a war with Iran? Bibi certainly hopes it does. Bibi's fondest desire, his bottom line wish, is to have the United States take on Iran for him and at least eliminate their nuclear program, if not eliminate Iran in terms of being any kind of contention with Israel. Will Trump do that? I think not. I don't know about the Pentagon. The Pentagon has been the brake on Biden. The Pentagon, under Lloyd Austin and C.Q. Brown, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, have said no, 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 repeatedly to President Biden and Blinken and Jake Sullivan, when they've said, we need to attack Iran, we need to do this, we need to do that. They have all been rebuffed by the Pentagon, and rebuffed with good arguments, because you don't rebuff the president of the United States unless you have a pretty good argument. And that argument is, you want 10 years of war, $1 trillion a year, thousands of casualties, and at the end of it, it'll look a little like Afghanistan or a little like Iraq. Do you want that? That's what the Pentagon's been telling them, because that's the truth. And so Biden backed away from that. Whether Trump will listen to that counsel, or even whether Trump will get that counsel, he certainly won't get it from Peter Hegseth. He wants to take Iran out tomorrow morning. So I don't know. All bets are off with regard to Trump and an attack on Iran.
Well, you mentioned Marian Adelson, Sheldon Adelson's widow. I think she's probably the reason why Rubio got the job, right? She's a close friend of his, probably lobbied for him. You got other plutocrats like Elon Musk putting up $200 million plus and obviously making recommendations, not to mention hanging out with Trump as though he's a co-president. And then, of course, you've got Peter Thiel, who bought a Senate seat for J.D. Vance, who I'm sure is being promoted to the vice presidency and possibly the presidency if anything happens with Trump's health.
Absolutely. And you've got the rivalry that will exist between Rubio, who wants to be president desperately, and anyone else, including J.D. Vance, who wants to be president or whom Trump wants to be his heir apparent. That's just an incredible tension. I saw that tension between Colin Powell and George W. Bush in the second administration, George W. Bush. Bush feared Powell being his major opponent in 2004, and it just soured the relationship between him, along with other things. So this is a recipe for a real mess if Trump can't handle it and manage it. Now, I'm sure he thinks he can, but if his first administration is any indication, he's not going to manage it as well as he thinks. And the situation that develops from that lack of management and lack of skill and knowledge could be very dangerous this time around. And let me just give you one place where it could be extremely dangerous. We have started to build out our nuclear weapons complex so that we can take care of, as it were, China and Russia combined. Now, this all started with a nuclear posture statement put out by President Obama, which assigned about $1 trillion plus to modernizing, securitizing, and suretizing, fancy code words for building more modern nuclear weapons in the Obama administration. But we're going whole hog at it now. And what we're doing is we're essentially trying to build a first strike capability. Why would we, a democracy, allegedly, and led by the people, allegedly, want a first strike capability? That's a huge question. Why are we doing this? But I can tell you the technological base is aimed at it right now. And China, having seen that, has come off its 200 to 300, maybe 400 at the outside nuclear warheads, and is going to build out so it can ride out a first strike. And their intelligence is telling them what I just told you. So they're probably going to build a warhead complex eventually that equates with Russia's. So then we're looking at not just 6,000 in Moscow, but probably 11 or 12,000 between the two of them. That means we got to build more. In other words, we're in a nuclear arms race, and we, the American Empire, we have destroyed every nuclear weapons treaty that we had, every single one, from the anti-ballistic missile treaty all the way forward to New START. We have destroyed them all. So we have no treaties, and we're building out furiously. And we've got a new competitor there, significant one now, North Korea, because I learned yesterday, Russia has given them the technology, and they can hit any target in the United States with their ballistic missiles now, including Mar-a-Lago.
So just in closing, though, Larry, given that we're wasting so much money on a first-strike capability with the new ICBMs, and ICBMs are, of course, inherently a first-strike weapon because they're on a hair trigger, because you basically use them or lose them. And this is what is the worst aspect of the Cold War. We survived that, and now we're initiating a new one. with the idea that we have our defense posture based upon beating the other side to the nuclear draw?
That's a good way to characterize it. And I'd say there's one other truly worrisome new development. During the Cold War, we could argue about Kennedy, we could argue about Ford, about Carter, about Nixon, and a number of other presidents, chief executives, but I don't think we would argue strenuously that they didn't understand the Cold War and how dangerous it was. All of them understood that. Now we are without leadership.
Well, Lawrence Wilkerson, I thank you very much for joining us here today. I appreciate it.
Thank you for having me. As grim
as this conversation is, but it's a necessary one, and I hope people wake up.
So do I. Thank you for the chance.
Thank you as well. And again, I've been speaking with Lawrence Wilkerson, a retired United States Army colonel and a former chief of staff to United States Secretary of State Colin Powell. In 2005, he went public with his knowledge that Vice President Cheney had provided the guidance that led to America's torture disgrace at Guantanamo, Abu Ghraib, and elsewhere. And he is now a senior fellow at the Eisenhower Media Network. We're going to take a brief station break. We'll be back assessing how the Democrats can move forward to meaningfully address a deepening crisis of liberal democracy without confronting the economic conditions that gave rise to right-wing populism.
Hear me, chief.
Welcome back. I'm Ian Masters, and this is Background Briefing, available 24/7 at backgroundbriefing.org. And joining us now is Wendy Brown, who's a professor of social science at the Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton. She's formerly a professor of political science at the University of California, Berkeley, where she was a core faculty member in the designated emphasis in critical theory. Her books include Undoing the Demos, Neoliberalism, Stealth Revolution, and Walled States, Waning Sovereignty, and In the Ruins of Neoliberalism, The Rise of Anti-Democratic Politics in the West, and Nihilistic Times, Thinking with Max Weber. And she has an article at Dissent, A Party Out of Touch. Welcome to Background Briefing, Wendy Brown.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me, Ian.
Well, thanks for joining us, Wendy. So, obviously, we're reeling from the, as most people that I know, we're reeling from the results of this election. And you point out that the fact that Donald Trump is the first Republican presidential candidate to win the popular vote since 2004 is very significant. And you attribute it to three things: Trump's economic populism in a context in which the Democrats have become the party of the elite, the exhaustion of liberal democracy as a viable, trusted form, and the destruction of education, especially higher education, in the United States. So let's start with the first one, which is pretty evident, that you have a divide in this country between the educated and the less educated, or as Donald Trump would refer to them, as the poorly educated.
Yes, if you want to start there. I thought you were going to start with economic populism, but we can start with education. Look, one of the things that this form of capitalism we've all come to call neoliberalism has done is put education, higher education, high quality liberal arts education out of reach for the many through spiking tuition costs, through the spiking housing costs for students. No matter how much financial aid there is, it simply doesn't have the viability for a working class or middle class student to take those 4 years and become a seriously educated human being, developing themselves personally, but also developing civic and cultural capacities, there simply isn't the possibility of doing that for poor working class or even many middle class students that was widely available in the post-war period up through the 80s. And the effect of that has been significant, as has been the effect of the right's frontal attack on higher education, both deeming it worthless and ideologically totalitarian. And put all those together, and what you get is a turning away from education, a turning away from intellectual ratiocination, we might say more generally. And it's certainly no fault of those who have been turned away from it or who have turned away from it themselves, because that's been the nature of both the economic life of the nation and the political life of the nation. But the effect of that, compounded by siloed social media and a very politicized mainstream media, was to create a steady drumbeat for Trump and for Trump's, shall we say, ideological coherence when it's not really there, for Trump's alignment with the working class when it's not really there, for it created the scene for really mass trickery. And again, I'm not saying that those who voted for him are stupid. I'm certainly not saying that they're without developed and solid views, but diseducating voters is an old strategy for the right. Orban uses it. I must say it's being used right now in Israel, as Israel is getting ready to get rid of UNRWA, the provider of education in the Palestinian territories. It's a very standard practice, and that's where we are with education.
I didn't mean to confuse you, because I guess there is a real link, of course, between the idea of being the party of the elite, because of the fact that the people who voted for Kamala Harris tended to be much higher income than the people who voted for Trump. And the core of it, I guess, is education. And what you've pointed out in your article is that beginning in the 1970s, everything about the system, going back to the post-war GI Bill, which was one of the most enlightened pieces of legislation ever happened in this country, that the education system, particularly in California, became under assault. Public funding was withdrawn, costs soared, classroom size expanded, and quality plummeted. So is this to do with selfishness, as was the case with Proposition 13, or is there some kind of purpose behind this? Because it doesn't make any sense on the surface. Why would you want a less educated people?
Well, we have to make some distinctions here. While public higher education was becoming less and less accessible, there was also a strong push toward vocational education. And that started as early as Reagan, but alas, was continued with the Clinton years, and even Barack Obama pushed building up community colleges and AA degrees against four-year universities and liberal arts degrees. And the simple answer to your question on the right is that a diseducated populace is very easy to manipulate, very easy to organize on the basis of emotion, on the basis of passion, on the basis of purely material interests. And at the same time, I would say more broadly, what you can see is the extent to which the assault on education as anything other than being valuable for job training, which is part of a broader neoliberal paradigm, the only thing worth doing in life is enhancing your human capital. As Thatcher said, there is no such thing as society, and the idea of a common good doesn't exist. So once you've got that reign of public reason, the effect is that nobody thinks about public good, common good. And what do you have Trump's voters thinking about? Prices. What is the price of my hamburger? What is the price of gas? What is the price of housing or a loan? And of course, Biden had the great misfortune to inherit the COVID economy and its inflationary dimensions. But when voters simply looked at that question, am I better off? Am I not better off? They said, no, I've got higher prices. I'm voting for the guy who says he'll make them lower. And, you know, that could bring us to Kamala Harris and why she didn't stick with a program that she launched at the very beginning of her campaign to address the question of not just inflation, but corporate price gouging more generally. And she talked about that for about 2 weeks and then tossed it aside. So the massive failure of the Harris campaign to take seriously where American voters were vis-a-vis their economic conditions, but also their orientation politically, which is just to think about their own self-interest. That was a massive failure on the part of the Democratic Party.
Indeed. I guess being from San Francisco, she decided to run against being a San Francisco liberal, embraced the Wall Street through her brother-in-law, the executive at Uber, and also seems to spend more time with Liz Cheney trying to win over yes. what's left of the sensible Republicans, which she could put in one room probably.
Yeah. So I agree with you completely, Ian, that the campaign decision was clearly to run to the center, which meant running to the right rather than to the left. And there was no center to grab. There was, you know, when you look at the numbers coming out after the election, she did not get one additional hundredth of a percentage point from so-called swing voters or undecided voters over what Biden had gotten. I mean, she did not win over one human being, but with that move to the center, and meanwhile lost the left, lost people who wanted a vision, lost people, I would even argue, those who identify as social conservatives, but didn't particularly like Trump, in fact, found him kind of hideous, but were looking for a program, a government program that would bring about a better deal for working and poor and middle class Americans. And, you know, I would go so far as to say Kamala Harris could have run on social democracy and won, while imagining that she had to dodge the socialist label. The truth is, most of the Americans who Trump got and she lost were people who just want a better deal, as well they should. And she, as you say, aligned with Wall Street. She aligned with tech. She aligned with the beautiful and the educated. And most of America is pretty alienated from that at this point.
So how do the Democrats get around this canard that simply being educated makes you an elitist? I mean, it's true in terms of the destruction of higher education. Obviously, in Europe, for example, Germany and other countries, they do have not just good universities, but they also have community college and trade schools. And here in the United States, I don't think community colleges have been properly invested in. And what the Congress has done is create a criminal operation called for-profit colleges, which are the most pernicious or fraud-riven. They basically give these vets and other aspiring people who want to join the middle class worthless diplomas and a lifetime of debt.
Yes. So it's, and at the same time, the proprietaries, as we call them in my business, the for-profit colleges, milk the state, that is the federal government, for financial aid. Part of what they're doing is putting students into debt through getting students to take out loans from the feds.
Right. So, 90% of their money comes from you and me and our listeners.
Yeah.
And they spend it all on advertising. And it's a massive fraud.
I will say that I think in some ways that particular problem is moving more into the rearview mirror than it was 5, let alone 10 years ago. Many of the proprietaries have been shut down. People have grown more wise to their advertising and to the junk diplomas that you described. So I think the problem that you raised, how does the DNC resolve the problem of identifying education with elitism and elitism with the DNC is a programmatic problem. That is to say, the Democratic Party needs to have a serious program for higher education. As you pointed out, we had one from the end of World War II, not only for returning vets, but also through essentially free public higher education of very good quality for anyone. And the desecration of that has also been the desecration of an educated working and middle class. And so that's one thing Dems need to do. Another thing they need to do is develop serious state projects that rein in capital rather than simply look for how to make capital invest in state projects. And that's a big task, but it's not an impossible one. And the U.S. is very well positioned to do this, but the Dems have been frightened of moving away from neoliberalism, whereas the right and the Republican Party have been perfectly willing to go more nationalist, to put limits on certain kinds of capital, and also more generally to develop a new state project. It's a horrifying one to many of us, but a new state project that actually promises all kinds of things to people. What does the DNC promise? To return to something that nobody was benefiting from. I mean, that was Kamala Harris's program. I'll make sure everything's stable and okay. And it's not stable and okay for people. It's not stable and okay at the level of income, at the level of education, housing affordability, let alone the problem of climate change. So the Democratic Party needs as radical a program as the right has. And then we have a real contest. You can no longer promise people who are freaked out and frightened about their own futures, let alone the futures of their children, you can no longer promise them that you're just going to stay the course. That was Hillary Clinton's mistake. That was Kamala Harris's mistake.
Well, I think you can also go back to Barack Obama. His mistake was when he took over. Obviously, the economy had crashed because of Wall Street and because Clinton had gotten rid of the Glass-Steagall Act. But that's when the right wing took over the Republican Party with the Tea Party, was their reaction to bailing out Wall Street. The Democrats should have been the ones that took the populist anti-capitalist message.
Absolutely. Couldn't agree more.
Instead of the Republicans.
Yeah.
So we're still, I mean, that's the genesis of the current situation, is it not?
It's part of the genesis of the current situation. The reason I keep pushing education is another part of it. Is what we've done. And I would add to higher education what we've done to K-12, you know, and we've allowed it to become politicized in ways that has the left reacting politically to everything the right does politically about education. And we should simply stand for educating citizens, educating human beings to be discerning, thoughtful people with multiple literacies across science and technology and arts and letters. It's a basic project of civilization, and the Dems need to stand for that. And the reason that, you know, I won't just say it's the result of the financial crisis and bailing out the banks is you also needed a situation, the one we have now, where through, you know, hyperbolic media, Fox and beyond, and social media, you could manipulate and bewilder people such that they could end up following not just Trump, but RFK and the rest of it, QAnon. We know this is the world. Not all the Trumpers live there. As I said, many of them simply voted on the basis of prices and a better imagined better economic future. But without an educated citizenry, it doesn't matter whether you bail out the banks or bail out the little guy, you're still going to have the potential for mobilized fascism.
Well, we certainly have an example of the death of expertise in almost all of the people that Trump is appointing, particularly to the key positions, Matt Gaetz at DOJ, Tulsi Gabbard at DNI, Pete Hegseth at although he's an Ivy League educated guy at Department of Defense, and most of all, RFK Jr. as Health and Human Services. And believe it or not, it looks like RFK Jr. is the one that's going to pass through the Senate.
Yeah.
The others may have a problem.
No, he looks like he's actually the moderate at this point, despite positions on anti-vaccine and QAnon and the rest of it. You know, but there's a frightening dimension of him. I mean, just yesterday he announced his plan to punish the poor again and humiliate the poor again by developing a long list of foods and drinks that people receiving assistance, WIC, SNAP, all the assistance programs in food that we used to call food stamps, developing a long list of foods that such people would not be able to acquire. And that's, you know, a fresh round of neo-authoritarian humiliation for the poor and the working class, and of course, single mothers above all.
Right. And he's meanwhile, he had to eat a Big Mac on Trump's plane.
Yes, he did.
After attending the gladiatorial UFC cage fighting at Madison Square Garden along with Elon Musk.
It's amazing what you have to do when you've decided to kiss the ring of power.
Right. Well, again, I don't understand. I mean, is this to do with the broader issue of America becoming more of a plutocracy and less of a democracy? And the history indicates that there's an ebb and flow. If you go back to the original Gilded Age at the beginning of the 20th century, is that, I mean, I guess what you have now in the form of Elon Musk and Peter Thiel and their protege, Vice President Vance, is a kind of malign right-wing tech-based plutocracy. On the other side, of course, even though Musk gave $200 million at least to Trump, Bill Gates gave what, $50 million to Kamala Harris. So, is that what we have now? The good and bad oligarchs.
Yes, and we also have a range of social movements. We have a range of peoples and formations, political formations, I would call them, rebelling against this position. I think it's important to see the potential in populism, not just denounce it. Populism is always a rebellion against elites. It's a rebellion against elite rule. And if Trump was lofted on the basis of economic populism, that also means there's a potential for mobilizing that populist sentiment for something other than a creature and a party that is using and abusing, exploiting a working class in order to enrich itself, in order to build a plutocracy. So the big answer to your question, what's the prospect of moving toward democracy, out of plutocracy, centers on the elephant in the room, it's capital. I mean, if neither party is really willing to take on the problem of finance capital, industrial capital, big capital, let's just call it that, and figure out a mode of governing and a mode of political life that insists on putting the planet and people on it before profit, if neither party is willing to do that, there's no prospect of moving back from plutocracy. And whether it has individuals like Musk and Peter Thiel at its heart, or whether it's just a plutocracy because it's ruled by the rich, for the rich, because capital is essentially, you know, saturated political life. And at this point, Citizens United, which used to be the big bugbear, you know, it pales next to the demand on the part of both parties for finance capital to be the source for their state projects. And as long as that demand is in play, we're not going to see democracy again.
So just in closing then, Wendy, in terms of your article at Dissent, A Party Out of Touch, you conclude by saying that will the Democratic Party finally recognize that it must advance another vision, one that serves the thriving of the many and the planet rather than the few and the profiteering, one that entwines capital from democracy and builds a transformative state project, one that takes seriously that democracy is rooted in an educated citizenry, not a manipulatable electorate, one that is appropriate for 21st century powers, problems, and possibilities. So just to finish up on the Democratic Party, what's happening now with the DNC? You mentioned the DNC earlier. There's talk about having Rahm Emanuel take it over. They're very defensive, the current head of the DNC, about what Bernie Sanders has been saying and his critique that, you know, they shouldn't be surprised that they lost the working class because...
Because they haven't been doing anything for the working class.
Yes,
I mean, look, when you said at the beginning, you know, you must be reeling from this election, I think a lot of us saw it coming, and that's not an I told you so. It was just so obvious. It was so obvious that Harris's joy and her bubbliness was speaking to a very thin strata of America. And yes, it was a relief from Biden's disaster toward the end of his run, but it was a relief only because it was a relief from Biden. So what I argue in the paragraph that you just cited from is preceded by saying that Trump's Republican Party is taking us toward a different form, a different political form, that the GOP is not afraid of leaving liberal democracy and its close entwinement with not just universalism, but capitalism, leaving that behind. And as long as that the right is perfectly willing to engage in revolutionary politics of this sort, for the Democrats not to do so is crazy. Rahm Emanuel is no solution. That's the same. That's the same, same, same. And Bernie, yes, we can applaud the one issue that he cares about most, which is the working class. He's right. But even that is not enough. We need a future of democracy that can take on transnational powers, including big finance, and transnational problems, including the disaster of climate change. And if the Democratic Party can coin that out of this crisis, then it has a future. If not, I don't think there's any future for the Democratic Party.
Wendy Brown, I thank you very much for joining us here today.
It was a pleasure. Thank you, Ian.
And again, I've been speaking with Wendy Brown, who's a professor of social science at the Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton. She was formerly a professor of political science at the University of California, Berkeley, where she was a core faculty member in the designated emphasis in critical theory. Her books include Undoing the Demos, Neoliberalism, Stealth Revolution, and Walled States, Waning Sovereignty, and In the Ruins of Neoliberalism, The Rise of Anti-Democratic Politics in the West, and her latest book is Nihilistic Times, Thinking Max Weber. And her latest article at Dissent Magazine is A Party Out of Touch. This has been Background Briefing. I'm Ian Masters, and I'd like to thank producer Graham Fitzgibbon and assistant producer Asher Price. If you missed any of today's program or would like to explore our vast archives, you can find us at backgroundbriefing.org, where we include extended interviews searchable by topic and have made it easier for you to sign up for daily email updates that provide links to resources, articles, and books discussed on the program. Also, you can find links there to subscribe wherever you get your podcasts, and we encourage your ratings and reviews on those platforms. And you can find us on Twitter and Facebook at Ian Masters Media. And please do help us reach more listeners by sharing this program with friends, family, and colleagues. And to help sustain this program into the future and assure it remains free to all, please take a moment to support us by going to backgroundbriefing.org/donate or to publictruthmedia.org, where your tax-deductible donations, large and small, keep us broadcasting. And I'll be back again tomorrow with another Background Briefing. Bye for now. Oh,
teacher and the other became a car. A car skidded into the rain, making the last little one to say, one more light goes out.